Thanks for staying with us. Now, against the backdrop of what many observers have called second wave of liberation in Africa, authoritarian regimes are being challenged by individuals and movements in search of more democratic forms of governance. Call for open and democratic governance characterized by popular participation, competitive elections, and free flow of information can be heard in many African countries. Now, yesterday we saw history being made as we celebrated the very first Democracy Day on the 12th of June. However, our guest has contrary views about the person the entire nation celebrated yesterday, as he tweeted, and I quote, "Anyone who sees MKO Abiola as a national hero should also consider Abacha, Obasanjo, and Babangida national heroes too, because they were all partners in crime." And he finished off with a tag, "Them all crazy day." Now, Oluwaseun Anikulapo Kuti, commonly known as Seun Kuti, is a Nigerian musician, singer, and the youngest son of the famous Afrobeat pioneer Fela Kuti. Seun leads his father's former band, Egypt 80, and has a very strong voice when it comes to national issues or issues of national concern. Now, remember, you can join this conversation. Tweet at us at Plus TV Africa or at Waysho Africa 1 with the hashtag Ways, or you send us an SMS or WhatsApp to 081-8038-4663. Thank you so much for having us.
Hold on. I think, I mean, it's great to have you, but I've been itching. I heard your quote, and I need to ask you, why exactly would you say that you don't consider MKO a hero? And if we should consider him a hero, then we have to add Babangida, Obasanjo, and all others to the list. Why is that?
Well, apart from my own personal bias due to our family's
history.
You know, I'll point Nigerians to a book called This House Has Fallen by German, I think German-American, or German, I don't know, his name is Karl Mayer. And in the book, he interviews IBB. Interviews a lot of big Nigerians, you know, and for some reason, they were kind of frank and open with him, maybe because he was white. I don't know. I don't know the guy, but I read his book. And in the book, IBB all but admitted that it was Abiola that sponsored his coup, their coup against Shagari, and also the subsequent coup to bring IBB into power against Buhari. So, like, how can a Democrat be involved in sponsoring coups? And I'm not the one that said it. You know, just because he did not get the ticket in that third republic, Abi, second republic, Abi, in the color. Yeah, so I think that is the kind of evidence that we have to look at.
But know? Do you believe
and
it?
And June 12 is bigger than Abiola. Me, I don't like it when it is reduced to just MKO Abiola, because many of the heroes of Nigeria are nameless and faceless. You know, in 93, I was 10. My dad was not involved in the movement at all. He was completely anti June 12th. You know, Fela all but threw a party in Calcutta when Babangida annulled the election. And he started calling, you know, and you know, Abiola was, even at that time, like, I'll fight for my mandate. I'll fight. Well, I see, that was president elect till he die.
Wow.
I'll tell you, it was almost prophetic. I'll tell you, I mean, people that came to shrine back in the day will tell you, like, even when he had won the election, Fela was saying it on stage, like, Abiola will never be president of this country. He will never be president.
Why was he so passionate about this, though?
I mean, Fela knows what he knows, you know, and Fela has dealt with them on levels that, you know, you and I can only
imagine,
you know. And also, you know, the worst of it all was when Simbiat and her husband went to lay false allegation against Fela, you know, that Fela and his boys came to rob Simbiat's car at gunpoint. And Fela was arrested for armed robbery, and then it was a penalty of death, you know.
Okay.
And Fela was almost killed based
the
on
process.
That case. He was in jail. They had arranged witnesses against him. Two witnesses had come to confirm that, yes, it was them and Fela. Imagine, that went to rob Simbiat.
Okay, so,
you know, you know, it was what? The third witness that now said, you know, because they didn't tell them who they were going to lie. They said, if you lie, we'll free you, you know. So when he got to court and saw it was Fela, he was like, I used to live in Calcutta. Fela doesn't like stealing. This is a lie, it's a setup. You know, I cannot. That's how Fela got off that case.
You know, today we want to talk about, because honestly speaking, I follow you very closely on social media. And I see that most times, even when the issues of Corona came, you kept on harping on, can we focus on Afrocentric solutions instead of just importing, you know, things, and we just say we want to implement things in Africa. That the key, what we have in Africa, right? We have a unique structure in Africa that whatever solutions that we want to bring, if it is not tailored for Africa, it cannot work. Mm. So if you also want to judge by our democracy, you know, based on what you know and based on what you've seen over the years, you know, is our democracy truly a progressive one for Africa?
Progress is relative. So if I ask Dangote if Africa is progressing,
he will tell you yes.
Absolutely. Fantastically so. You have examples of so progress is relative. What I think we need in Africa that we lack is representation. Whatever the system of government is, I mean, we need something that represents everybody, where all Africans can be involved in determining their own future. And not only that, to also create the environments where people can meet their potentials. Because many people waste away because there are no programs in Nigeria to meet their potential, no matter how talented they are. Because there are no local programs, and many of them cannot afford to leave the country or are not lucky enough to meet a big man that will sponsor them. You know, they end up wasting away here in Nigeria, you know. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's one of the biggest disappointments and also indictments of our political and business elites in this country. That young African robotic engineers, young African astrophysicists, astronomers, astrologists, you know, young African nuclear physicists, you know, theoretical physicists, you know, these high-end jobs that demand heavy brain power are not encouraged. There are no grants, no programs to match this potential in young children that are talented like that.
Yeah.
You know, and even when you're talented like that, you're now forced to become event planner, cake maker, chef, banker. You still have to go to school and then that one. You know. I mean, even with your bankers are the ones doing a tailor.
No,
I have my very good friend was a banker. The Grammy I wore, the Agbada I wore to the Grammy, she's the one that sold it. So that was in Nigeria, you know. So and that's what really, that's what for me. I don't, at this point, I don't really care about democracy too much. I think it's highly overrated. There can be discussion around it. There can be discussion about it. What I believe right now is that we need an Africa, we need a government that just is ready to fulfill the potential of African people.
Okay. You know? So a new taxonomy for corruption is playing out currently in Nigeria. And like in the political arena, like the one that happened in Edo State with Adams Shomole and Obaseki saga. And we also have a situation whereby an individual was incarcerated and he came back and became a lawmaker. So
yeah, because the judgment was null and void.
Yeah, so what is your take on this?
No, but I mean, Nigerians must realize that it is one rule for the people and another rule entirely for the ruling and ruling elites, you know. So, I mean, and that's what plays out in many different forms. People always say, you know, if you're talking about American politics, they're like, oh, the Democrats and the Republicans are two wings of the same bed. Mm. I say in Nigeria, APC and PDP are one wing of the same bed. I mean, even have, the bed is a one-wing bed.
So it's not able to.
That's
like
why the country is not moving well. Because it's one wing, the bed is just doing like this. And then the wing, it doesn't even agree very well with each other. You know, we're the same wing, you know. So that's why I find it easy for politicians to. I mean, imagine as Bernie Sanders lost the primaries in America, he now become a Republican to contest.
So what do we need to complete this other wing? Make it that's
what I'm saying. The people need representation, and this is where the Nigerian professionals need to come in. You know, people always say we need to unite. I'm like, I don't care, don't unite, but donate together.
So how?
Yeah, we need to create a platform. We need to make it our. I said it last time I was here. Nigerian professionals need to start aligning with the people. We have to see what they go through as what we go through, instead of aligning with the oppressors to try and afford the comforts under oppression. You know, because that's what we do as professionals, you know, and the elites really know. So they set themselves as gatekeepers on all the things we need to survive. They shut down the public schools or make it below par. And who wants to send their child to a below par school?
No one.
Then the elites build expensive schools, knowing that your salary cannot afford that school, but you need to send your child there, you know. So they do that, whatever order they give you in the office.
You will do it.
You will do it. They said there's no public housing. They are the ones that build all the houses. We go and rent it. They charge us exorbitant rent. They don't care that, you know. My godfather told me that everywhere in the world, turnover for every building project is about 20 years. You need to wait 20 years at least to make your money back. In Nigeria, it's 7.
Wow. That's crazy.
Wow.
7 years.
Turnover. Wow. In 7 years, they already made the money of that building back. Anything that I'm making extra now
is extra.
It's just...
And that's not supposed to be the standard.
I mean, I'm
so
saying,
do you feel... Okay.
Because there's no long-term, you know, plan. Our elites act like parasites. So extract. You know, all of them position themselves in industries where we need to survive. So banking, where you need to keep your money. And then they make sure that the system does not work if you keep your money at home. You
exactly.
know, you can't do many things anymore. You
see,
so you have to go and put your money in their bank. You have to live in their homes. You have to eat their food, use their cement to build your house, put their fuel in your car. So it's just what we have that they sell to us, you know. They don't really add to the country. Like you see somebody like Bill Gates adding Microsoft to the United States, or Apple by Steve Jobs and his own Steve Wozniak and all these guys that do the things that they do for their own nations. We don't have elites like that. So that's why these programs are lacking. That's why, you know, there are no investments to develop the people. You know, there's only a system of extraction. So what we need is the professionals of Nigeria need to shun this ransom operation, because it's really they kidnap us, you know, by defunding public services. No public hospital is good, so you have to also go to their expensive private hospital, you know, and they hold us to ransom, you know. So now, poor people cannot afford these things that we can afford. So their children die. Because their children die, doesn't mean we strike. May I announce 75 people killed in Kaduna, everybody in Nigeria will go to work tomorrow.
They just moved on.
That's painful.
Everybody in Nigeria will go to work tomorrow. The professionals don't care. And it's in the hand of God. It's in the hand of the professionals that the power to liberate a country lies.
So how do we push the professionals to actually do?
You can't push people, I mean. And that's one thing. People have to decide. It has to be deliberate.
No, but you know what? So, okay, before you came on the show, a colleague of ours, Ekene, she's on The Advocate. We were having a conversation, and she was talking, and she was saying that, 2023. And I told her, I said, I don't see anything happening in 2023.
Anything different?
Anything different happening in 2023. But however, right, if we are strategic about where we're going, and we know that, okay, this is the plan, this is where we're headed, we can make... we can make a statement in 2023. But this change that would happen would not be a 2023 journey, because it didn't take us 4 years to get to where we are today. And I understand you correctly, because, I mean, when they did Occupy Nigeria, everybody ran out there, they were singing. And
even
now,
because they increased foil. That's the time we strike.
You know, but even
because
at that,
foil affects us too.
By the time they told them that, you know what, your jobs are at stake, by the next day, everybody ran back to their jobs, because nobody, you know. So we are like, our hands are tied, right? So are we looking that if we truly want to change this country, we must reach that level of a revolution? If we must, because...
Not the level. We must reach a level of resistance.
Okay.
We must be able to resist their methods of oppression. So as I've analyzed, as people have seen how glaring it is, and we know in our hearts that we should be on the side of our people. We are the majority, right? They cannot run their factories themselves. They cannot. If we truly, truly, truly in Nigeria decide to stand in solidarity, see, that's why they fear solidarity in this country.
Yes.
So if you go to church, the first thing your pastor is telling you is how not to trust your brother, your sister, your uncle, your auntie, your best friend, your husband, your wife, your brothers, your sisters, even your children. Don't trust your mother, don't trust your father,
your
everybody, especially those people in the village that cannot eat or clothe themselves but have some kind of power to hold your destiny back.
in some churches. So
you watch
our
TV,
churches are liberated.
If you watch TV, it's the same thing they say. Yeah. In majority, you know, of the things.
The narrative, yes.
The narrative is the same, you know, just attacking the solidarity of the people and putting salvation in the hand of the oppressor. So your story and your prayer, let one rich man bless you, or you want blessing like one rich man, you know, set themselves as example in society. Mm. The people oppressing society are not the example. That's why it's difficult for us to liberate ourselves, because many people are looking up to these oppressors as, you know, things to aspire to.
Yes.
You know, so.
You know, you talked about solidarity, and I find that very interesting, because one of the major challenges we face in Nigeria, even in politics generally, is tribal differences. So a lot of people will tell you, yeah, I don't think we deserve democracy because we are just like over 200 different tribes. So how are we going to come together? What do you agree with these people, that tribe is one of the major reasons why we're not having pure democracy in action?
No, not really. Not really, because we've not really had any true representation, as I said before, you know. Tribal differences in Nigeria, for me, as heinous as it looks, is also quite superficial. It's also quite enforced. It's also quite, it's a bit manufactured, you know, because, for example, when they say Yoruba people hate Hausa people, I say to them, but all of you work in Dangote's factory. Mm. You like Sanusi, you praise Ribadu. What part of this time are you hating Hausa people?
Mm.
You know? And they say Hausa people hate Yoruba people. Well, they all like Fela, and they all listen to Sonia Ade, you know. And Tinubu goes there for rally, and they all follow him. And Buhari, say Baba, say Baba.
So it only comes when they want that narrative to play out, that it plays out that day.
Yeah, because, yeah, we actually see it in politics. Sorry to cut you. Like, I've noticed that when you see all these political campaigns and the pictures, you see them working. Oji Zokalu came out, when was it, the other day? And the welcome party they had for him, I saw Hausa people there, I saw Igbos, I saw Yoruba. So up there, it's like it's one big happy family.
So, yeah, that's what I'm going to like. Mm-hmm. So
yeah,
from the top, there's a propaganda against the poor. So when you say I hate Hausa people, you actually say I hate poor Hausa people. Mm-hmm. When you say I hate Yoruba people, it means I hate poor Yoruba people.
Mm-hmm.
When you say I hate Igbo people, you mean I hate poor Igbo people. Because if you have the opportunity to meet successful ones, you want to meet with them.
Absolutely.
So it's really, really an anti-poor propaganda that is disguised as tribalism. So
it's interesting that you mentioned MKO, because I was just telling my ladies here, you know, this morning I was watching a TV station, and they interviewed the wife of the late MKO, one of his wives, and she kept on saying that I think he got to that state because people were asking him, why did you go into politics? You had made all your billions, so why did you have to go into politics? And she kept on saying that he got to that point where he looked at it and he said that somehow, like, maybe posterity will not forgive him
because of the amount of... Look at these rich men for Africa, forget all these billions.
Wait, let us finish.
How many of his companies are still working today?
Today, I understand. Let's leave that one.
Let's leave all this story.
Wait, that is another argument.
He was looking for presidency. Yeah. He wanted money.
Okay, sure.
I will not... See, this is what we do.
But okay,
we sit down, you journalists, this is your problem. People will sit down, somebody will just be talking, nobody will ask them important questions.
Yeah.
Like, if these billions were really there flowing like that, what happened to all the companies?
Mm.
Why isn't one still around?
Yeah.
Where is the legacy of this business mogul?
Yeah.
Everybody, business mogul.
No, but you know, that's another...
Is it today? We've seen them. See, people should go and pick up history book about this country.
No, Shane, listen, even this thing you just said, I've seen it play out. And we've had a show talking about why businesses don't last in Nigeria. So that is a symposium discussion. It's a big issue. We know. You understand?
Nobody should not tell me somebody has billions.
You know, interestingly, when this young man was arrested, Hush Puppy, you know, Terry G came out to say
that
there's one Gucci gang guy, that was arrested for fraud. In Dubai, you know, he's a Nigerian. No, so this guy came out to say a lot of people are not pure. In all honesty.
Why do you know him?
No, because I'm in the news. I need to know him.
Why do you need to know him? You said he's a criminal, Abi?
No, I've not said he's a criminal. He was arrested for fraud. I don't know what...
For fraud, okay. For fraud. He's innocent until proven.
So the point I'm trying to make...
Interesting shows on his...
Shame, wait, let me make my point.
I'm just wondering why people follow these kind of people.
I don't follow him. It just made news, so I had to see it. So the point I'm trying to drive at is that, you know, I was making a statement to someone. I said, if you call even all the billionaires that we have today, a lot of them cannot truly trace how they made their money. So this thing you're talking about, businesses dying, that it does not outlive. No, some it's of them God. Cannot trace. No, it's not God.
It's God. I've not read one interview before that they asked one of them. And the first line that comes out is
it's not God.
It's not God. It's God.
It's not
first
God.
Thing is God.
But you know what? There's a question for you. Angela says, kindly ask Sheun if we can work with current political parties or a new build-up is required for the current political parties. That's from Angela.
Well, you see, Yoruba have a proverb. You see,
speak it in English because...
Wait. What kind of play is the lion play with a dog? I mean, the dog play with a lion.
Serious play.
You know, so for me, I think the vested interests of the established political parties are too strong and well versed in their ways for people to come from the outside and truly make, you know. But you can have allies. We can have allies within those movements, within those parties, you know. Within those structures, you know, but there must be something without that is really pushing the wish of the Nigerian people.
Yeah.
See, Nigerian people cannot wait for these greedy people to be satisfied first before they we are now satisfied or we are negotiating with them for our satisfaction and our own existence.
Yeah.
We no longer have the time, you know, like we need to.
Okay, so in follow-up with that story or that question, I also had something that I call the APC trick and the PDP trick concept of the political parties of Nigeria. So where the people are giving two unavoidable Mephistophelians to actually represent the political parties. So how do we break away from this norm of having two people that we don't really want?
Devil and the
blue sea.
Exactly. Rock and a hard place.
Exactly.
That's why I stopped voting in presidential election in Nigeria.
Thank you.
I just got tired of having to just, you know.
So don't you think that's like giving up your voice?
I vote in states and local elections. I mean, I think.
Okay, just presidential.
I'm tired.
But you keep saying we should represent.
Yeah, so this is what I'm saying.
So
is this.
You shouldn't be tired.
Nigerian professionals, I'm not tired. I'm tired to vote. Okay. But I'm not tired to be politically active, right?
Okay.
So I have a movement during elections. I'm sensitizing. I'm trying to help out, you know, at least from all the plenty parties we have. I always, you know, look for parties on the Socialist Party of Nigeria. Nobody talks about those parties because they don't have money to share. But there are very great parties in this country. SPN being one of them, that they just doubt this. They say because they didn't win any seats. They want to remove them because they know that's a strong platform for the workers of this country. They can get their consciousness right and understand what the SPN is trying to offer. You know, so they trying to, this party, to register the party was war.
The problem.
Now they've yanked
No, but you see, Sheun, this is where I think the problem is, right? So when can we get to that point where we stop to have the underdogs, I'll call them, all those political parties that you said they are strong, but they are still considered the underdogs because they do not have that they don't have the financial power, they don't have all of those things. So where can we now set aside our personal interests? Because even with these underdogs, you still see a lot of personal interests play out. So if we say we want to save this country and truly, you know, you called it get that resistant movement and all of that, is it not high time we all come together, you know, and say, okay, you know what, let us leave PDP and APC and all this underdog come together and form something that will stand, you know, to fight against.
First of all the underdogs cannot come together to form one kind of party to fight against, because first of all, I believe in ideology.
Okay.
Many of the parties are capitalist still.
Yeah.
And some are socialist.
Conflicting
some are,
ideology.
Yeah,
so I think the capitalists are just little of the big parties. So me, I don't really listen to what they have to say. But they are progressive pro-people's party. You know, AAC was going to be one of them, but they got something fundamentally wrong in the beginning. I don't want to go into that. And it came back to bite them in the behind. But, you know, so what I think is, if Nigerians are able to raise their consciousness and become more deliberate in our political participation. Now, let's not blame Nigerian people, because people do it a lot. Oh, Nigerian people don't participate in elections. We don't like politics. It's not our fault. We were banned from politics literally from 1960 to 2000. Exactly. We are not allowed to do any, we had no experience. And not only did they just ban us from politics, our political leaders are on the side of the people who are eliminated, killed, harassed, sent on exile.
Exactly.
So nobody to actually mentor a new generation, nobody to actually show people how to be politically active. So Nigerians need to also be given a lot of credit for how active we are just 20 years, you know, into our own participation, basically. Learning to crawl, walk, fly, and jump all at the same time, you know, because it's not as if everybody in the country is pulling for the country's progress, right? The most powerful people in the country are not pulling for the country's progress.
Yes.
So imagine that. And we, the people, are still trying our best to pull our country in the right direction. You know, in our naivety, in our lack of understanding, in our infantilization and everything, but we are still trying. You know, and we just need to try harder. Nigerians need to become more deliberate. Say, okay, the way you are deliberate about going to church, going to your mosque, or watching your favorite TV show, or making sure you go to club every weekend, you have to become deliberate about the development of your country. You understand? So inform yourself. Give yourself, because don't see it as, oh, you are being political. See it as you are serving your children. You are creating the right country that you want your children to. Like, oh, these 2-3 hours this week, I'm dedicating it to the future of my child.
Yeah.
You know, I want to find a political
and sign up and do thing something.
Near me as organize. Yeah. You know, let me, I want to volunteer. I want to, if more professionals are thinking like that, the workplace itself will become more politicized. People will be able to have more discussions. You know, people will be able to resist the oppression that comes out from the corporations and the big businesses and government office,
right.
You know, that comes to affect the people. You know,
right.
Workers will stop seeing themselves as just pen pushers and fire carriers. Yeah. You will see that they are exactly the front line.
They have a voice and they can make a change.
Exactly.
Right. Nasiru is saying that, why are we numb to death of our people? So when we hear what has gotten us to this stage where we hear that 70 people were killed or
in Southern Kaduna.
Yeah, Southern Kaduna, and nobody says anything.
Well, you see, the thing is, I think you have to, let me use the analogy of a father and a child. So if a father has been beating a child, you know, beating his children all the time, you know, the mother at some point will have to become numb to it until she decides to maybe leave him and take her kids. So I think that's the situation of the Nigerian people. The Nigerian government themselves, who are supposed to be our protector, who are supposed to be our father figure, have been the worst abusers of Nigerian people. Nobody has killed Nigerian people more than Nigerian government. By direct impact, indirect impact, negligence.
Yeah.
I mean, the list goes on. I told you that polio is back in Nigeria. People don't know what I'm saying, that the impact of that. Polio, an eradicated disease.
Came
that
back.
The world has celebrated the end.
In fact, I watched Bill Gates' story on Netflix, you know, when he was talking about the history of polio and how he took up that challenge, you know, to fight it. It's crazy.
Back in Nigeria. Cholera killed that many people in Enugu last year. Not to talk of Lassa fever.
Yeah.
That one is still going on.
Yes, it's still
and then on. Malaria that they're the not world even talking has about fought, the news. We are still fighting it.
Because they can't close gutter. Clean drainage. They can't even invest in good canal system. We'll let them go into all that. You know, so I think that for me is what we as Nigerian people need to do. We need to become more deliberate.
Wow.
We need to see it as service for our children, something we are doing so that our children do not have to live the way we live. They don't have to compromise their humanity for survival. You know, because I always say to people, I don't know the nature of the people I live with. Nigerian people have to scrap so much to survive. This is survival. We are all surviving, you know, as in the midst of scarcity.
Exactly.
You know, people are living. I mean, when there was nothing that was paining me more than seeing Nigerians queuing during COVID so that rich people in the estate can be giving them one plate of rice.
Wow. Oh dear.
Grown men with their children. I mean, where's the dignity when you have to queue on the street? Your existence is not worthy of food. No, you have to queue for this. People should give you their, you know. And those ones are only doing it because they don't want you to be angry enough to burn their house down and change the system. They want to keep status quo, you know.
Yeah.
Keep your spirit
let's give you the palliative.
Keep your spirit of dependency going.
My God.
That's the truth, you know. So
wow.
We need to become more deliberate, and time is going.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And on that time has gone enough with us. Really, you know, you always make it perfect. Fun for us all the time.
Yeah. Perfect. Time for
Shehu, you have to come back again, but you have to come back early, Shehu. Quickly, Sanzi.
I was only 5 minutes late. I tried now.
You did. Fantastic.
Fantastic, but you can be a lot more prompt.
Yeah. Hey, I've been 10 minutes late to IG Live interview.
Let's go. All right, so basically what stood out for me from what Shehu has said, he said a lot, obviously, and I like how he slides his points subtly, you know, no be fight. So representation is very important, solidarity, we're going to make a change, let's start with that. And also, when think of it like you're trying to create a better Nigeria for your children, you're serving your children, I think that's very important.
Absolutely.
What he honed into my head was participation is key.
Very key.
It's right. Paramount very key. In everything we do.
Yeah, yes. And I like that part of all people have to be represented.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you're going to start with representing us. All right, so.
Don't worry, I'll be chairman of the party.
Yeah, so in case you missed today's quote, here it is again. Of what use is democracy if it's not for the poor? I mean, it's absolutely useless. That's our quote for today. So thank you so much, Shehu Nkuti, for coming. Remember to watch the repeat broadcast of this episode tomorrow at 3 p.m. And we'll see you live at 8 p.m. tomorrow for another great conversation. Enjoy the rest of your evening.